Okay, good, this thing's on. Hi, everybody, I'm Kim. So I just want to say thanks for having me here. I'm stoked to be here and to talk shop about design and product development. Those are two of my favorite things to talk about. I just want to start off with a little bit of background and tell you sort of about my career so far. So I used to work at the New York Times, and actually shout out to the New York Times folks who are here tonight. You guys should really invite them down to talk at some point. They're a really awesome group of people. But yeah, so I worked there. Obviously it's a pretty big company. There are a lot of designers, a lot of art directors. And I actually had two jobs there. So I started off working for the physical paper, art directing the op-ed section. And it was kind of a crazy time. It was in 2008. I worked through an election. I worked through the market collapse. And it was a totally wild ride. And then I moved to the digital design team. And I worked on news and editorial and product features. And then around 2011, I moved to Etsy. So I go from the Times to Etsy, which is a much smaller company. At the time I joined, there were about 200 people. By the time I left, there were about 700. I saw quite a bit of scale during the time that I was there. And I was the design lead of the buyer experience team. And so what that means is essentially I was working with the product teams that were responsible for all of the things that you would experience during your shopping experience on Etsy. So that's things like landing pages, shop pages, product pages, checkout, search, discovery, that big umbrella of stuff. And like I said, when I came on board, the design team was pretty small. There were only seven of us. But then by the time I left, there were 25 designers. So that's a lot of personalities. And we faced some interesting things to think about from a design point of view, beyond like thinking about how you design the best user experience or product experience. We're also thinking about design's relationship to the other teams in the product org. And I just want to brag on these guys a little bit, because this year we also got a National Design Award, the Etsy Design Team, and that's a huge accomplishment, and I'm super proud of them for that, and I think it's really great. And now, to bring you up to speed, I'm at Cover. So I'm the design lead at Cover. Cover is a payments platform for restaurants, and so essentially you go to restaurants, you tell them you're paying with Cover, and then we take care of the rest. You can leave when you're ready, you never have to exchange a check, you just dine on your own time. And there's only one designer at Cover right now, that's me. All right, so that's my background. I've worn a lot of different hats. I've designed for a lot of different verticals. I've, you know, going from news to commerce to now dining and payments. I've also designed at a lot of different scales. You know, the New York Times, it's pretty big. Etsy's pretty big. At Cover, we're a team of like 15 people total. We're just getting started. But I think that regardless of what context you're in, there are certain, you know, principles and best practices around design that can help set you up for success. And so that's kind of what I want to talk a little bit about tonight. So this is your kind of like typical product cycle. Like say you have 3 months to build something. You spend time in a design phase, you spend time in a build phase, you know, you build the product, and then you release it, and you look back and you measure, you're like, did we do a good thing or not? And there's a problem with this, right? There's a huge problem with this. The problem is you go through that design phase and then you go through the rest of the product cycle and you have no idea whether you're doing a good or a bad thing. You're not giving yourself a chance from a design and product perspective to iterate on that idea. So when I was at Etsy on the buyer experience team, I led one of the most successful projects in the company's history. We redesigned the product page, and ultimately it led to this magical increase in conversion. And I'm saying magical increase in conversion because I was recently informed that I'm under NDA and I can't disclose those actual numbers. But so it didn't go like this. Like, I didn't put my designer goggles on and craft a vision for what this thing needed to be, and because I'm an awesome designer, I made the best product page ever. Like, it didn't work like that. And it certainly wasn't just me working on the project. I was working with these guys. I was working with the product manager and the engineer, and it actually looked more like this, right? So we were working seamlessly, and design and product decisions, and I want to emphasize, like, design decisions were coming from everywhere. They're not just coming from me. And I'll talk more about this later, but I think that's really important to setting yourselves up for success. And also, it wasn't one design, right? We experimented with almost 20 different design variants, and we iterated a lot. So our timeline looked more like this, rather than having one timeline or that one period where we're just design and building and measuring. We broke it up into shorter cycles so that we gave ourselves an opportunity to essentially fail. That first experiment went horribly. The design was beautiful, but like bounces went up like 5%. And to be honest, it actually wasn't that clean. It kind of looked like this, right? So like we were designing something, putting it out there, working on our next iteration while we were waiting to get feedback on how that one was performing. So I don't know how many of you have read Malcolm Gladwell's book, The Outliers, but he kind of talks about like a similar phenomena. He talks about success and the things that make people successful, and he postulates that success is not a single event. Like, it's not that someone gets incredibly lucky. It's not that you're incredibly visionary or skilled. But it's actually the outcome of multiple events and multiple factors. And he spends an entire chapter talking about cockpit culture and airplane crashes, actually. And he talks about how airplane crashes are actually, so in this case, this is failure, this is not success, but airplane crashes are the result of 7 human errors on average. So it's not like Liam Neeson is flying the plane and something terrible happens and all of a sudden you're in a nosedive. There are actually multiple things that lead up to that event. And he tells two stories. And the first story is about a flight, a long flight that was going to land at JFK. And they were put into a holding pattern, you know, how you sometimes do at JFK. It's kind of rare that you're not. And they were running low on fuel. And eventually they were in that holding pattern long enough that they ended up crashing outside of JFK in Long Island. And then he tells another story about a flight that was in a similarly risky position, where they found out that they had to make an emergency landing shortly after takeoff. And that's really dangerous because the plane is full of fuel and the pilot needs to land in an airport that he's not familiar with, that he wasn't expecting to land in. But they made a safe landing. And the difference between these two situations, outside of one crashing and one not, the plane that crashed, the cockpit communications were silent. They're like in the recordings, the pilots were barely talking to each other. They were barely communicating with ground control. And in the flight that was successful, there was a ton of communication. As soon as they found out that they had a problem, they were problem solving with each other. They were communicating with ground control, and they landed successfully. So here, success is not a question of qualifications and skill. The pilots knew how to fly the plane, they were skilled pilots, but it became a question of teamwork and communication. And I think there's a lot of parallels between that and product development. It's not as morbid, but we're skilled designers, we're skilled product managers, we're skilled engineers. We know how to solve these problems. But at the end of the day, it does really come down to like how we're working with each other and how we're talking to each other. There's this designer Cap in Brooklyn, and in full disclosure, I'm married to the guy, but that is a different story for a different time. Maybe if I have enough beers, we can talk about it later. But he has this saying that design is for everyone, and outside of my bias, I think that's a really interesting saying. And he talks about design being a process, right? Like, if you think about design as a process and not just an artifact, then everyone becomes a designer. Everyone on your team becomes a designer. So these are the people that I build products with, right? Like, I build products with engineers and product managers. We use data and research to inform our decisions. We work with content strategy on crafting a meaningful message. Our work supports the vision of the co-founder. When you think about it, design is really a process. And so the question for me then becomes, like, how do you get people involved? And so this has been one of the most valuable lessons in my career, like, offering transparency. Ed Catmull, he's the president of Pixar, he talks about how transparency is really valuable to the animation teams there. And he talks about how they have an emphasis on showing work every day and showing work when it's incomplete. And he talks about how if you do that, then eventually you get over the embarrassment of that, and then you can be more creative, which I think is really interesting. But even beyond being more creative, what I found is that it helps you build relationships with your team. And when you're building relationships with your team, when you're getting people involved, you build trust. And so I get folks involved by sharing every single step of the design process. So I'm getting engineering, product managers, everyone involved from stage one. I'm getting them involved in flows. I'm getting them involved in early prototypes. We're all looking at this copy doc to figure out feature copy. I'm sharing the really messy bits with them. I'm broadcasting all of this stuff so that we can create relationships and we can have conversations. Basecamp is the tool that I use to do this. I think there are a number of ways you can do this. Also, like, face-to-face conversation is always good. But when you're sharing all of that with your team, then stuff like this starts to happen. You start to get that conversation and you start putting your heads together to solve hard problems. And when you start putting your heads together to solve hard problems, then people start becoming invested in the work. They become excited to build it, they get attached to it, and they want to make it the best that it can be. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Jen. We'd just love to leave room for a little bit of Q&A. Quick one I want to start with. So you came from a couple of medium and large organizations, and now, you know, working on a smaller team. As you look ahead and you're going to grow the group, like, what are the first two or three hires that you think about making as you build an organization?
Design-wise?
Design-wise.
Yeah, that's a good question. And it's interesting because I'm not sure how much this changes at scale. And it might have to do with a lot of my process, but I really look for, sort of skill-wise, like a full-stack product designer. And when I say full-stack product designer, that means that I'm interested in someone who can own and contribute to every step of the process. We're not really, like, looking for specialists, right? And part of that maybe is because we're so small, but as you can see, like, we're working on flows, we're working on wireframes, we also have an emphasis on coding. Some of that comes from my background at Etsy. Yeah, so full stack product designers.
Thank you. Yep. So any questions from the group? Come on, don't be shy.
Don't be shy.
Here we go. I'd to see your name and where you work.
My name is Erica.
Oh, that's a good one.
How do you become again one?
Right. So how do I manage and handle a divided situation between teams? So I think you're talking about when people have a difference of opinion, right? There are a number of ways to go about this. So first off, like Google Ventures actually has a great resource, like the Google Ventures blog is a great resource for like, for kind of product design and management. And they kind of have this like voting system, which sounds maybe a little cold, but honestly, at the end of the day, if you're trying to get things done and you just give people a marker and you're like, okay, put your vote on your favorite idea and we're gonna run forward with this, that's not too bad at the end of the day. Also, you know, and I'm gonna like steal this answer from an interview I did with a product manager like a year ago, but I thought it was a really good answer in terms of avoiding conflict. If you lay the groundwork well in the beginning, so the one step in my process that I didn't share, before I'm doing flows, I'm sharing a problems and goals document with the team. So essentially, like I'm writing down what are the problems that we're trying to solve and what are our goals. And I make sure that everyone kind of agrees to that in the beginning. And so when everyone is oriented against the same milestones, then conflict becomes less likely.
Yep. Great, we have time for one more.
Hey, my name is Sean. I work at a company called MediaMath. I have a question about the Etsy product page design.
Yeah.
So you mentioned you did sort of this continuous design process.
Yep.
And that the first version sort of tanked.
Totally.
Versions. So that implies you were doing some testing like live with
yep.
the actual site.
Yep.
So was that sort of like a holdout with certain users, like a small percentage, while everything else was the way that it was? And then
yeah.
Before that, did you actually do some user testing with just offline with smaller groups?
Yeah, that's a great question. So at the time that we did the product page redesign, user research, unfortunately, was not as much of a process, part of the design process at Etsy as it has become. Etsy has since built out like a really big user research team, and it's definitely kind of like the first place that we start. We eventually ended up doing user research kind of in the middle of that cycle through usertesting.com, which still was like not the ideal, in my opinion, not the ideal way to do it for the type of project that we were working on. But we did get some qualitative input. But yes, it was a highly like experiment-driven project, and that's something that like Etsy kind of has the luxury to do, right? They have a ton of traffic, so they can set things up that way, and they also have very sophisticated tools for experimentation and bucketing. So to answer your question, we essentially were showing those views to 5% of traffic that matched our bucketing criteria. At Cover, what I'm doing now is like, you know, we're a much smaller company, we're early stage, we're doing a lot of qualitative stuff. So I spent my day today trying to find user research participants for some upcoming sessions that we're running.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah, totally.
Big round of applause.
Cool. Thanks, guys.